Hey all, welcome to ShareTrek. This is your host Raj here. Friends, today I came across a new HIV treatment initiative that uses CRISPRCas, but it's in its early stages and the researchers claim that it also targets dormant cells or hidden reservoirs, which we are always concerned about. So I think it's now time to take a closer look. Let's get started. Welcome back, friends. I came across a research press release presented ahead of the European Congress of Clinical Microbiology and Infectious Diseases. The short form for this is ECCMID 2024. It highlights a groundbreaking approach in HIV therapy led by Dr. Elina Herrera Carrillo and her team at Amsterdam UMC Netherlands. The study showcases the potential of CRISPR-Cas gene editing technology to eradicate HIV from infected cells and offering hope for a cure. Dr. Elina has a background in biochemistry and has a focus on developing gene therapies for HIV, and she has spearheaded innovative research in this field. Her multidisciplinary approach combines molecular biology, virology, immunology, and gene therapy to explore novel anti-HIV agents. I think this gives her a very, very unique perspective and a greater chance to succeed. CRISPR-Cas gene editing is a revolutionary technique in molecular biology, allowing precise alteration to the genomes of living organisms. There are a whole lot of Cas nickases, as they are called. The one that is more popular is CRISPR-Cas9, and it has its own limitations, but it is the very first editing technology that became popular in the last decade or so. And this technology was recognized with the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2020. And it functions as molecular scissors guided by RNA to cut DNA at a specific location. This enables targeted removal or unwanted genes or introduction of new genetic material in the location of the cut. HIV's ability to integrate into the host's DNA poses a significant challenge in treatment. Current antiviral drugs effectively manage this infection, but lifelong therapy is necessary due to viral rebound from reservoirs. And these lifelong medications also have side effects on various organs of the body. The new breakthrough system offers a promising approach to target HIV DNA and potentially achieve a cure. The study focused on using CRISPR-Cas to eliminate HIV from infected T cells. By targeting conserved regions of the virus genome, the researchers aim to develop a broad-spectrum therapy effective against multiple HIV variants. And so far, everything is looking exactly like EBT-101, but you should notice the fact that I'm just saying CRISPR-Cas, I'm not saying CRISPR-Cas9. So therein lies the difference. Efforts were made to overcome logistical challenges such as the size of the vector used to deliver CRISPR-Cas9 and components into cell. Techniques to reduce vector size were explored, facilitating more efficient delivery to infected cells. The effective CRISPR-Cas systems came out of evaluating different CRISPR-Cas systems with promising properties. And finally, they settled on SaCas9 as the nickase that they are going to use. And SaCas9 demonstrated outstanding antiviral performance. The strategy of minimizing vector size enhanced delivery to HIV-infected cells in the study. So they settled with SaCas9, which is basically Staphylococcus aureus Cas9. It's a type of Cas9 enzyme, which is a protein found in the CRISPR bacterial immune system. And CRISPR-Cas9 systems are used for genome editing, which is a technique that allows scientists to make changes to an organism's DNA. SaCas9 has several advantages over Cas9 enzymes, such as SpCas9, which is commonly used with CRISPR. SaCas9 is smaller than SpCas9, which makes it easier to deliver into cells using viral vectors. SaCas9 also has higher editing efficiency than SpCas9, which means that it is more likely to make the desired changes to the DNA. And here are some of the key properties of SaCas9. SaCas9 is smaller at 1,053 amino acids long compared to SpCas9, which is 1,368 amino acids long. Higher editing efficiency of SaCas9 can create single-stranded breaks in DNA, which can be used for homology-directed repair or HDR. This allows precise repair at cut site using a template. SaCas9 cuts DNA at the intended target site with fewer off-target effects. That's also another benefit. The study also targeted hidden HIV reservoirs by focusing on specific surface proteins. This approach improves the precision of CRISPR-Cas delivery and enhances the potential for therapeutic success. I did not know that it was possible to identify HIV-infected cells using surface proteins. Since it is possible, according to this team, I imagine that the surface protein will be present both in visible as well as hidden HIV-infected cells, which means with a single algorithm, they can target both hidden as well as dormant HIV cells. While the findings are promising, the researchers emphasize that further optimization and preclinical studies are needed before clinical trials. And that goes without saying. That's the same sequence for any treatment that you look at, where the research starts with a petri dish, preclinical, then it goes into a non-human primate, and then into humans. So ensuring both efficacy and safety of the proposed cure strategy is paramount before considering human trials. This is indeed encouraging. Here are my thoughts based on past experience reviewing therapies, not only in the domain of HIV, but also in areas like sickle cell disease and beta thalassemia, etc. I have a few points to make so that you can manage your expectations. First, I think moving from success in preclinical trials into in petri dish and into a non-human primate is a big leap. This is because the controlled environment of the initial experiment in a dish may not be present in the non-human primate's body. Many therapies have achieved this leap, but it is not an assured thing. Secondly, the HIV inserts itself into the host DNA in random viable locations, and sometimes more than one copy in a DNA. This increases the complexity of search and edit for any potential therapy. Third, for the first time, I am hearing that even hidden reservoirs can be detected by surface proteins. We need more information so that we can be sure that it works in non-human primates and also that it addresses all hidden reservoirs regardless of cell types. Fourth, HIV at times is known to integrate in the wrong spot on the host DNA, leading to cancer or autoimmune diseases or cell death. This means it is possible that HIV could be integrated near such a spot, not on the spot, but near such a spot, and the patient is okay before editing the virus. But because of the edit, there is a danger that the dangerous zone of the DNA adjacent to which the HIV has embedded itself could probably be edited by accident and cause some issues. So that risk will be there, in my opinion. And the reason I say all this is not to say that this initiative will fail, but I want you to have a realistic expectation. The reason I mention this is because it helps understand the challenges the team are facing while designing the target and editing algorithm so that they can avoid these situations. Now, let us look at the positives of this approach. Smaller Cas molecules means more space in the delivery vector to supply repair template and use HDR so that every cut is repaired perfectly the way it should be. SaCas9 can perform single-strand cuts, and this avoids all the negatives of double-strand cuts, and it's more accurate than the standard Cas9. SaCas9 is used in base editing, which is far superior to CRISPR-Cas9 editing. However, I'm not sure how it is being used here. One way for me to think is that when HIV embeds itself into host DNA, it does not make a cut on the host DNA. It joins its two ends to the host DNA and becomes part of the DNA. So if Cas9 nickase is being used, SaCas9 nickase is being used, and it can do single-strand cut, then I suspect it's going to be doing all the operations on the HIV genome rather than on the human genome. I'm not sure. We have to wait to see more information when the paper gets published so that we can understand where exactly this cut is being performed. I think we should wait for ECC MID 2024 to be over so that we can get to see this research paper and get more details of this approach. So stay tuned. One thing we can be sure about is that it's definitely different from EBT 101. And we know how EBT 101 approaches. It's just a matter of time. In a few months, we'll be able to understand how Dr. Herrera approaches HIV with her therapy and what exactly is the logic of treatment out there, where the edit is being done and how the repair is done, whether it's done with a template or not. All those things will become much clearer. Hi guys, I would like to interrupt the programming just to make a request. We have a Patreon which will support this channel. So if you're interested in supporting this channel, please join our Patreon. The link is in the description and your support is much appreciated. And if you don't want to go to Patreon, you can join as a member of the channel And I have an ultra low membership of $2.99 per month, which is as low as buying a cup of coffee. So I hope you would find it convenient to support the channel, which brings you a lot of latest information on HIV. Thanks. Hope to see you in the membership section. With that, my friends, I would like to bring this video to an end. Bye for now.